Dame Vera Lynn is one of Britain's greatest national treasures. She's the working-class girl from the East End of London who became the voice of a nation. We'll meet again some sunny day. As we celebrate Dame Vera's life, we share a century of memories.
We saw a few Japanese soldiers, woke up one morning and found four of them outside my hut.
And meet the veterans from the front line who talk of the hope she brought them.
When we were out there, she was the whole world, really.
We were all singing and crying at the same time, all putting our arms around one another.
We discover how Dame Vera became a British legend and gave such joy to so many.
When you listen to that voice, there's a kind of tingle.
She's like family, even though you may never have met her. You feel like you've got a contact, as there's a bond with her.
I would put Vera Lynn very high on the list of unique contributors to our civilization.
She really is one of the great British popular music artists of all time.
They'll be happy to know that as you saw me so, I was singing this song.
There'll be bluebirds over. It was here in London's East Ham that Vera Lynn was born. Now, for most of us, when we think of her, we think of the Second World War. But in fact, she was born during the First World War, on March the 20th, 1917. By the time she was seven, she was already singing in public, a little working-class girl singing in working men's clubs. So how did someone with absolutely no formal musical training go on to have a stellar singing career that would span nearly a whole century? Born Vera Welsh to Dad Bertram, a plumber, and Mum, Annie, a dressmaker, the Welsh family loved music and quickly realised that Vera had a good voice. So good that she fast became the family's main breadwinner. Just
keep on wishing. You took for your stage name Lynn, didn't you?
Yeah, it was my grandmother's maiden name, Irish.
Because Lynn sounded better than Welsh?
Yes, yes. It was easier for publicity. Mm. I thought it sounded nice.
Yeah. Did you like singing when you were very young?
I was all right. Once I was on, in full swing, I was OK. Once they found I could sing, they used to take me all round all the working men's clubs in London. They were great audiences. There were no microphones in those days, because my voice was much louder, because I sang in a higher key. Mm. When you started using the microphone, I had to lower my tone of my voice. Yours, till the stars lose their glory.
Yours, till the birds fail to sing. Yours to the end of life.
The voice was so genuine. It was unfiltered. It wasn't a trained voice. And it never has sounded like a trained voice. She just opened her throat and out it came. This clear, vibrant, full of emotion, bell-like voice. And it stops you in your tracks.
Even though she's technically brilliant, she gets the emotion. You get some singers who are technically superb, but you're not quite sure they really care what the song is, they're just showing off. With Vera, I've always felt the key thing is that she understands exactly what the song has to get over, and she does it brilliantly.
It's a very clear voice, and it's sincere. You know, you get the feeling that she's singing from the heart.
You didn't ever have singing lessons apart from when you were older, and that didn't last long, did it?
No, I never didn't have singing lessons. I just went once. I thought I could extend my range. But when she heard me sing, she says, no, I can't train that voice. it's not a natural voice. So I said, well, thank you very much, madam, and left. I wonder if she ever heard me when I was on the radio after that.
If you love me, really love me, let it happen, I won't care.
Radio was to come calling for Vera. She was about to make the transition from East End to West End. One night, age 15, singing here at Poplar Baths, Vera was spotted by local band leader Howard Baker, who signed her up on the spot. She was going to be catapulted into the glamorous world of the big band scene.
Love is like a cigarette. Love seems to fade away and leave behind ashes of regret. And with a flip of your fingertips, it was easy for you to forget. Love is like a cigarette.
First of all, I would look at the lyrics, and if I liked the lyrics, then I would listen to the tune, because I thought the lyrics were more important than the music.
Mm, mm.
And I liked it. We set the keys and the arranger would come and hear me sing it so that he would know where to put the emphasis on any backing.
One evening long ago, a big ship was leaving.
Vera had a real talent for picking her own songs, trusting her instinct, knowing what she was good at, and that would prove to be the key to her enduring success. By the age of just 22, she'd sold over 1 million records. She'd bought her parents a house. She'd bought herself a little car. Life was sweet. But then war broke out, and Vera worried that that could signal the end of her career. Little did she know, it would in fact become her and her country's finest hour.
No such undertaking has been received, and that consequently, this country is at war with Germany.
She was more than just a recording singer. She was the voice of an era when civilization was actually under siege.
When she first became famous, the lyrics really mattered because England was a fortress.
Wish me luck as you wave me goodbye.
The government quickly realised that entertainment on the home front was vital to boost morale and give the great British public some respite from the horrors of the bombings.
Oh, look, you're
oh,
Austin.
Oh, look, my little Austin 10. I love the hat, don't you?
Yeah.
Snazzy hat. It went everywhere in that little car, all through the streets with the raid on.
You used not to like going down to the underground, did you? You preferred to just drive
No,
home.
It was so hot, so I used to get fed up after a while and go up the top, and I thought, well, I'll take a chance. If there's anything up there for me, I'll get it, no matter where I am.
Close your eyes.
One night, whilst performing, Vera met the man she would marry, clarinet player Harry Lewis.
You first met Daddy when he was playing in the orchestra, didn't you?
Yes, in the Squadronaires. It's a great band, that, Squadronaires. There was all the leading musicians that were in the business.
Yeah.
All joined up together.
Yeah.
And Harry and Vera married before he was sent away to fight.
Let's pretend that we're both.
Already huge on the variety circuit, Vera became an even bigger star when she was given her very own BBC radio show called Sincerely Yours.
Sincerely Yours, Vera Lynn.
The curtain of night will part.
We lived in a council house. And in the living room, you'd have your couch and a couple of armchairs and a fireplace. And there would be the radio. It was your world. So you would hear Vera's songs on the radio all the time.
When I was little, Mummy and Daddy would park me by the radio to listen, and on would come this wonderful voice.
by the fireside.
And she would say, now, listen to this, Miriam, because this is special.
A little kiss.
It seemed to me that the voice, that wonderful diction, that warm, intimate mezzo-soprano, Vera Lynn, was as much a part of the Second World War as the voice of Winston Churchill.
Dear boys, this letter of mine is getting to be a sort of rendezvous where husband and wife...
It was a good way of trying to communicate with the boys that were away. I'm yours sincerely. I'm sincerely yours.
I've been getting all kinds of letters from people with worries, asking me what I do in their situation. I'd like to...
The show was an instant success. A mixture of chat, song and letters. Newborn baby announcements from the wives Vera visited and requests from soldiers abroad.
This time I've a tune that sings of the peace and calm of married life, of cosy evenings by the fireside.
Vera chose one of her favourite songs, We'll Meet Again, as her radio signing off tune each week.
And that's all my news and music. You'll hear from me again next week. Good night, boys. Sincerely yours, Vera Lynn.
We'll meet again. Don't know when.
We'll meet again. How did you find that?
I sang it before the war.
Yeah.
It was just a song that was sent to me, and I rather liked the lyric. And I thought that's a good song, you know, because it goes with anyone, anywhere, saying goodbye to someone or parting, you know.
Mm.
Hope we'll meet again.
Till the blue skies drive the dark far away.
Vera Lynn told us something. And, of course, it was a message the Allied world needed. She sang songs of optimism, hope, redemption, reunion. It was at a time when it was very unlikely that we would win the war.
If I was one of these guys who was away fighting a war, how amazing would it be to hear Vera's beautiful voice singing about home?
People could identify with her. They felt this is, in one sense, an ordinary person singing what we feel. It was the fact that she was like somebody you might know in your street.
Vera continued to work tirelessly on the home front, but she decided it was time to go and sing to the troops in person. And so she joined up to the Entertainment National Services Association, ENSA for short. Vera could easily have decided to entertain the troops in Europe, but instead she opted to visit the soldiers in the Forgotten War in Burma, as they were trying to repel the brutal Japanese army from marching west into British-controlled India. Vera arrived there in April 1944, at the start of a major enemy offensive.
Yes, Burma, the hats.
Yeah. What really decided you to go to Burma?
Well, I just wanted to go somewhere that nobody had been before.
Yeah.
Any artists. So they said, well, nobody's gone to Burma yet. So I said, right, that's where I'll go.
I am a real fan of Vera because she did so much to cheer us up when things looked grim. She was a forces sweetheart very quickly. She was one of us singing to us. And she came all the way out there at a risk, certain risk, to entertain us and cheer us up.
Show me the way.
It was on the end of some paddy fields. She was singing underneath a light. As soon as she finished, I'm sure the Japanese heard us cheering and clapping. It was absolutely marvellous that she should come there when so many of our entertainers didn't. I had a wife and daughter waiting for me at home. She brought them closer.
There is no object to this letter. It's just that I felt I must show my appreciation of you travelling over 6,000 miles to sing for the boy.
I've just received a letter from my eldest son in hospital in Burma, who tells me how you paid him a visit and how you entertained them.
And in the jungle where radios aren't up to standard, and there's not so many anyhow, we've been inspired and comforted, so we wish to proclaim you our 1st Battalion sweetheart.
Somebody ought to get cracking now with, I suggest, Sweetheart of the Jungle. You're the first English girl I've seen and heard in this part of the world.
I think four of us went down to see her. How we found it, I don't know really. But I know we travelled for 2 hours through the jungle to get there. It was packed out with servicemen. We were all pushing to get as close as we could really to where she was.
It's a lovely day.
I can't remember whether she had musicians with her or anybody else at all. No, it was just Vera for us. We were all singing and crying at the same time, all putting our arms around one another. It was just great to see her, really, to think what we were going through there. It was a good bottle of medicine, it really was. We'll meet again, don't know where. Not easy.
There's Len on the left. You just had Len Edwards on piano, didn't you?
Yes, we used to carry that around with us, not literally, in a little truck. It didn't suffer an awful lot when you consider in the state of the roads. But we did have a trouble one time when we just started the concert and the sides fell off of the piano. And the boys had to rush up and hold the sides on before we could continue this program.
I was in the Royal Berkshire Regiment. I was in Burma in 43. It came along the grapevine that Vera Lynn was in the area, and she put on a concert, believe it or not, right in the front line, at the bottom of Garrison Hill in Kohima itself, where the major battle took place eventually. We thought this has come too far, but I understand she insisted on coming up to the front line. To me, that was bravery.
Were you ever frightened?
No, I knew I was being taken good care of. The boys never left my side.
There'll always be an England.
With the tide turning in favour of the Allies, Vera returns to England to host another series of her radio show, which once again broadcast both at home and abroad.
We spent 3¾ years as slave workers of the Japanese. We had no contact with the world at all. We could have been on the back of the moon. And we had been freed, and I think the RAF had dropped us a radio. We were sitting in the jungle in the middle of the night. Suddenly, there's this voice. Suddenly, that's England I'm listening to.
Here is our song together tonight.
We knew her before the war as an ordinary entertainer, but when we were out there, she was more than that. She was the whole world, really.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover.
To hear her say, there'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover, I could see those cliffs. I thought, we are going home.
And laughter and peace ever after. Tomorrow, when the world is free.
What made you choose the White Cliffs of Dover?
Because it was the last thing the boys saw when they went away, and the first thing they saw on the way back.
And peace ever after.
Ever after.
Tomorrow, just you wait and see.
Just you wait.
Oh dear, oh dear.
And see.
I didn't think I was going to sing this morning.
It must have been so reassuring to the servicemen and women to have somebody like her sing so strongly about home and about how things were going to be all right.
You felt we might win the war, you see, when we heard songs like that. You just got the message of optimism.
There'll be bluebirds over the white cliffs of Dover.
You're on your way home, would you see the white cliffs in the distance? You can't help it. You just can't help it.
As far as it's possible for me to feel emotional, I feel emotional listening to that.
No words. It's in the song.
We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing.
When you hear the your home again.
As loved ones were reunited all over the country, the war was over, but Vera's career was most definitely not. Over the next few decades, she would have hits on both sides of the Atlantic, she would tour the world, she'd have primetime TV shows, and even in her 90s, have a number one album. She wasn't just the Force's sweetheart.
You see, she lived on after the war. The war was the most thrilling and important episode, perhaps, in her life and the life of the country and those of us who were living at that time. But she went on performing, she went on singing and giving joy and pleasure and using not just radio, the original medium, but then she went on television so we could all see her.
Vera was on television a lot in the 60s, 70s. And it was good that television wasn't always just chasing the newest fad. She had a warmth that came over. She was somebody who people welcomed into their front rooms.
It's your programme.
Oh, yes.
They were fun, those, weren't they?
Oh,
those shows.
Yes.
Good dancers, all of them.
Oh, yeah, they were always kidding about...
Yours till the stars.
In the early days of the Beatles, it wasn't just rock and roll shows. There would be, like, variety bills. So we'd be on with a lot of various different acts, and Vera was on one of them. And so we were like, wow, we were totally amazed. It was like, Vera Lynn. You know, really, we were so sort of, pleased to meet you, Vera, you know. And she was so great. She was really so sort of chummy. She didn't pull the big sort of hello. It was like, all right, mate. She was very sort of, you know, down to earth. So we really liked her and immediately went home and told everyone we've met Vera Lynn.
In the grey of December.
Fast forward to 1995 and Vera was in her 70s and you'd think it was time for her to happily retire. But it was the 50th anniversary of VE Day, and Vera was an essential ingredient. The commemoration took place here in grand style, and it was watched by millions at home on television. Vera Lynn the Entertainer had become Vera Lynn the Icon.
You'll get no promotion this side of the ocean, so cheer up my land, rest the more. Come on again, bless the more. Bless the
Dame Vera's appeal has, of course, continued way beyond her initial fame and fortune and huge success as a popular singer on record in the 40s and 50s, because as recently as 2009, she had a number one album of many of her greatest recordings. And it can't have been selling primarily to her generation, because sad to say, not too many of them were around. It sold to all generations, and her songs and her voice are timeless and obviously very good.
Vera became the oldest living artist to ever have a number one album. That album was called We'll Meet Again, and the title track is probably Vera's best-known hit.
We'll meet again. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Keep smiling through, just like you.
That's her great song, I think, We'll Meet Again, which had a special resonance during the war years, but it's still effective for us now, I think.
If I hear it on the radio, I just think, what a great record. What a wonderful recording, and how much good it did. You know, it was much more than just another pop song.
They'll be happy to know that as you...
Wonderful.
The way she used the vibrato with vowels. Because I always say that consonants carry the sense and vowels carry the emotion.
Don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day.
That was Vera, all right, no messing. And she could sing it nearly as well as I can.
Yeah, I know every word of that song. Yes. Oh, my word.
We'll meet again, everybody. Don't know where, don't know when, but I know we'll meet again some sunny day. Oh, dear.
You must remember this. A kiss is still a kiss. A sigh is just a sigh. The fun